Hello and welcome to Civil Services 2015 Mock 1 Analysis. As we all know, Civil Services exam consists of 50% of verbal ability and logical reasoning section and another 51% of quantitative aptitude, data interpretation and analytical reasoning. Now here we're going to talk about verbal ability and logical reasoning questions. This paper is based on actual CSAT paper 2014. Now a characteristic feature of actual CSAT paper 2014 is that it consists of lengthy passages. Now how do we deal with those RC passages, because RC is comprises of more than 50% of verbal ability section in paper 2 of CSAT. Let's go to this particular question to analyze, to understand how to deal with an RC passage. Now look at this passage based on poverty. Before going through this passage, it is important to go through the questions that follow, because that will tell us what I am supposed to focus on while I am dealing with the passage. The first question says, what are the reasons for poverty in India? So the keyword here is reasons for poverty. Next question says, what is true about competition policy? So I'm supposed to focus on competition policy, and what is true about anti-competitive practices. Okay, now when I'm reading the questions, I need not focus on the options. I only need to understand, I only need to quickly read the question stems so that I can go back to the passage, so that I can move from the passage simultaneously to the questions and then back and forth, so that I can answer the questions while I am reading the passage. Okay, now let's begin reading the first paragraph. It says, poverty is one of the biggest challenges today for the developing countries. So clearly it's about poverty being challenging. The second paragraph gives the reason. It says, in India, problem is more acute as the situation has been aggravated by high density of population. The reason being, high density of population, poor land-man ratio, high unemployment rate, poor performance by the agriculture, and poor absorption of labor force by the industrial sector. Right. And the third paragraph talks about, it says, over the last decades in, okay, before I go to the third paragraph, I have already got my answer to the second question in the second paragraph, to the first question in the second paragraph. Okay, so let's go back to the question. It says, what are the reasons for poverty in India? It's overpopulation, yes. Infertile land, not mentioned in the passage. High unemployment, definitely. Weak economy, no. So clearly my answer to this question is option B. Now going back to the passage, the third paragraph talks about what are the initiatives that have been taken to curb poverty. Right, it says over the last decades in India, several programs were initiated to curb poverty and positive results in poverty reduction have been achieved. Further, significant improvement has been observed across human development indicators such as literacy, life expectancy. So what has happened in this particular regard, that is in regard of reduction to poverty, these are the achievements that have taken place. These are the consequences of policies that have been, but what has been done in this direction has yet not been mentioned till here. This is the consequences of what has been done in this direction. Okay, now let's see what has been done. India's economy has grown steadily over the decades as a result of implementation of several economic policies, including competition policy, with an aim of enhancing consumer welfare and reducing poverty levels. Okay, so what India's economy has increased, how? Because of implementation of several economic policies. Implementation of economic policies, what kind of economic policies? Competition policy. This competition policy was introduced with the aim of consumer welfare and reducing poverty levels, and it has worked in the favor of reducing poverty. So therefore, this is the area that focuses on competition policy, on which the second paragraph is based. Let's move further to see if there is anything else about competition policy. Like other economic policies, competition policy is also a complex relationship, also has a complex relationship with poverty. Greater competition leads to well-functioning competitive markets and promotes innovation, productivity and growth. All these factors positively affect reduction of poverty and generate employment and prosperity. So how competition leads to reduction of poverty is given here. And then role of competitive authorities has become extremely important in the context when rising prices have an adverse impact on the poor. Okay, so competition definitely would have reduced the prices because rising prices have an adverse effect on poor, and competition leads to reduction of poverty. And the next line says anti-competitive poverty lead to higher prices, right? And it has its greater impact falls on the poor, is on the poor, as it reduces their access to essential goods and services. Okay, now let's read the second and the third question. It says, which of the following are true about competition policy? It breeds competition, definitely yes. Which is directly proportional to poverty? Directly proportional means that if competition increases, then poverty also increases, which is completely against the grain, which is completely what the passage states. The passage states that competition increases and poverty reduces, right? So this is factually incorrect. Two says competition increases prices of essential goods and services in the market. This is true for anti-competitive practices and not competition. Therefore, this is incorrect. It works in favor of consumers. Yes, this is true. This particular line here, it says that competition policies have been introduced with the aim of enhancing consumer welfare. Right. So, yes, it does work in favor of consumers. Fourth says it helps in the development of a country's economy. Economy, yes, India's economy improved as a consequence of implementation of economic policies like competition policy. So therefore the answer to this question is option D, which is 3 and 4. Okay, next question is, which of the following is or are true about anti-competitive practices? Anti-competitive practices have the greatest impact on prices of essential goods and services. Yes, it impacts prices of essential goods and services, but the passage does not say that it has greatest impact on essential goods and services. It says that anti-competitive practices have greatest impact on the poor in comparison to other sections of the society. Right? So this is rendered incorrect by this statement. Two says they hit the poor the hardest. Yes, this is what we just read. They are for consumer welfare. They cannot be for consumer welfare. That's not even given in the passage. They fall under the category of bad economic policies. We do not know if such a category exists. Or anti-competitive practices have only negative effects when it comes to economy. Right. So therefore, the answer to this question is option A, which is only two. Now the given passage here is based on law. We'll deal with it in order to brush up our technique of dealing with RC again. And as we've seen in the previous question, we are going to deal with the passage once we've read the questions that follow the passage. The first question says that we are supposed to consider the following statements and then find out which of them are correct. So appointment of law officers is not rational. So the passage talks about appointment of law officers. Justice Kirubakaran believes that the petitioner's plea to transfer the case is reasonable. So there is some petitioner whose plea to transfer the case, and what is Justice Kirubakaran's take on it, right? Next question is, which of the following statements are unfair? Okay, we can deal with it later. The next question says, according to the passage of the following, will Justice Kirubakaran agree with? So this man is of importance. So when we're reading about this particular person in the passage, we need to be slightly more cautious, because this is what helps us answer the questions. Okay. Now let's move to the passage. It says, a law officer should be a law-knowing person and not a political leader-knowing person. Madras High Court noted and expressed the hope that the government would frame appropriate rules at the earliest to make law officers' appointment in a rational manner. So what has Madras High Court done? It has passed a rule to frame appropriate rules at the earliest to make law officer's appointment at the rational manner. In a hard-hitting order, Justice N. Kirubakaran observed there was no yardstick prescribing the minimum period of practice and expertise in special law for appointments as law officers. So Justice N. Kirubakaran, he gives a flaw in the present appointment. It does not consist of, it does not prescribe any minimum period of practice and expertise in special law for appointment as law officers. Okay, now this is the first paragraph talks about the need of the hour, and the need is appointment of a person should be fair. That is, he should be a well-knowing, law-knowing person and not a political leader-knowing person. And what is the flaw in the appointment of such a person is that there are no proper guidelines for the appointment, right? No proper yardstick to adhere to, right? Now, the third paragraph says the post which an advocate gets depends upon the amount of influence and political patronage. So this is what is actually happening. It is the influence and the political patronage of the person that helps him get the post he's aiming for and not his merit. Some of the advocates who do not have sufficient expertise in law, in court practice, and who do not know fundamentals of law are being thrust on courts as law officers. Why? Mainly because they are party loyalists or known to the family members of friends or top leaders. Okay, so this is how their appointment happens. So first paragraph talks about the situation. Second paragraph talks about what is lacking that causes this situation, and third paragraph actually describes the situation. Fourth paragraph says Justice Kirubakaran made the observation while dismissing a petition by M. Prakasan seeking to transfer trial of murder case in which the petitioner was an accused from the principal district and sessions judge Tiruchi to the PSJ Pudukottai. So this is man M. Prakasan. He is seeking to transfer a murder case from one court to another. Why? Because, so he gives reasons. He says that the two witnesses who were sons of the victim were politically influential persons, and that they would use their influence and would influence the case against the accused, right? While the justice observed that both the accused and the witnesses were from the same ruling party, so the allegation that political influence was not sustainable, right? And there was no material to prove the petitioner's contention. If really there was an apprehension on the part of the petitioner, he could have approached the court at the earliest, right? So he finds he's not kind of satisfied with the petition and thinks that it is completely unreasonable or baseless. Political loyalty. Justice Kirubakaran said, in spite of being statutory appointments, law officers are appointed on the basis of political loyalty. So this is like a restatement of the first paragraph. Appointment of law officers is on the basis of political loyalty. There may not be any problem if the candidate was meritorious and loyal. Okay. If the candidate was meritorious and loyal, not a problem. But a problem arises when he gets that post on the basis of political loyalty. Right, and he's not meritorious. He reminded political parties that the interest of common man and the state would be protected only by honest, meritorious and legally sound advocates with impeccable integrity and character. Also, the High Court should be consulted by the government before appointing law officers. So this is what should be done. What should be done to get over the problem? Okay, it should be protected. The right to justice of common man and the state would be protected if the law is honest, if the law is in the hands of honest, meritorious and legally sound advocates who have impeccable integrity and character, and that the High Court should also be consulted when appointing law officers. Okay, now let's read the questions. Question is, with reference to the passage, consider the following statements. Appointment of law officers is not rational, definitely. The first paragraph here says that appropriate rules are the earliest to make require that what is required is appropriate rule at the earliest to make law officers' appointment in a rational manner. So clearly till now they have not been rational, and therefore the need arises. So therefore this is correct. Option 2 says Justice Kirubakaran believes that the petitioner's plea to transfer the case is reasonable. This is against what the passage states. Justice Kirubakaran is not at all convinced with the petitioner's plea, and he thinks that it's totally unreasonable. Therefore, the correct answer to this question is option A. Next question is, according to the passage, the following statements is or are unfair. Relatives of politicians are thrust on court as law officers if they are advocates. This is incorrect. Not every advocate who is a relative of a politician is thrust on the court as law officers, right? So this particular phrase in the sentence renders this option incorrect. In spite of having sufficient expertise, some of the advocates are not appointed as law officers. Not appointing law officers and reasons for it are not discussed in the passage. All that the passage discusses are people who use their influence of knowing the leaders, political leaders, to get the post of law officers. Third option is, even advocates who do not know fundamentals of law are made law officers if they know the family members of top leaders. Yes, reference to this is given here. In the third paragraph, it says that the post which an advocate gets depends upon the amount of influence and political patronage a concerned candidate has in the party and with the family members or friends of the party leaders. Some of the advocates who do not have sufficient experience in court practices and who do not know fundamentals of law are being thrust on courts as law officers merely because they are party loyalists or known to the family members or friends of top leaders. Right, so from this we can say that 3 is correct, and therefore the answer to this question is option C. Next question is, according to the passage, the following will Justice Kirubakaran agree with? A law officer should be meritorious. Yes. A law officer should not be loyalist. No, this is incorrect. Here, let's take a look. Kirubakaran says that, said in spite of being statutory appointments, law officers are appointed on the basis of political loyalty. There may not be any problem if the candidate was meritorious and loyal. So loyalty is not a problem. Problem is that political loyalty without merit is incorrect. Okay, so third option is a law officer should be appointed by the High Court. This is also incorrect. Why? Because the last line says that the High Court should be consulted for their appointment. Whether High Court takes the complete decision of appointing the candidate is incorrect. Right. So the last paragraph here says, take a look. Also, the High Court should be consulted by the government before appointing law officers. Okay, so consultation of High Court is recommended. Not that High Court should actually appoint the person. So the correct answer here is only one, that is option. Other than RC question, the paper also consists CR questions, which we'll be discussing later. Now let's go on to discuss a critical reasoning question. Since CSAT also consists of a few critical reasoning questions, here in this particular question, we are supposed to find out a flaw in the argument given in the passage. Okay, now this passage says, once inside the edible foods, heavy metals such as lead and nickel can make their way to the consumer's body, where they can contribute to neurological and other health problems. So, heavy metals ingested through edible foods, what does it have? It affects neurological and other health problems. Okay, the only way to really get rid of the heavy metals in water is to treat it with filtering agents like activated charcoal, but those types of materials are kind of expensive, says Shore. Okay, so what we should be doing is treat them with activated charcoal, the solution to the problem. They're a little expensive for us to use, but they're very expensive to the people. After testing various samples of plant from cacti to flowers, researchers determined that Cilantro is the most prevalent and powerful so-called bioabsorbent material available. Bioabsorption is a scientific term for using organic materials often found in plants that, when dried, could replace the charcoal correctly used in filters, currently used in filters. So this this particular substance, that is cilantro, can replace charcoal currently used in filters. The team has found that the outer wall structures, the tiny cells that make up the plant, are ideal for capturing metal. So this is the best way of capturing metal, but that is through cilantro, because it has certain features. Hence, Shore suggests that cilantro should be widely used and popularized in the commercial markets by manufacturers and water treatment devices to make contaminated water drinkable. So the aim of the of this filtration of water is to make contaminated water drinkable. Okay, now the first option, this, how to find out the flaw in this argument? The aim of the is to attack, if something negates the aim of the passage, right? The aim of the passage is to make contaminated water drinkable by use of cilantro, which is capable of replacing charcoal. It's the best way of, it's the ideal method of filtering water. Okay, now option A says, although cilantro allows water to trickle down after absorbing metal, it still leaves out other impurities in water. So clearly this can be a flaw in the argument. Why? Because it still leaves out other impurities in water. If it leaves out other impurities in water, then the aim of this, of using this widely and popularizing it in commercial markets, it fails, because then water is still not worth drinking. So therefore the answer to this question is option A. B says cilantro is expensive and hence people will not be able to use it. Well, that has not been discussed. The passage only says that it is expensive to people, but it does not say that that people will not be able to use it. If it affects people's health, then it makes sense to spend some money on it. Cilantro has to be dried before using, which will take a lot of time and space. The passage nowhere states that there is any paucity of time or space, and that it is therefore not feasible to use it. A lot of cilantro would be required to make contaminated water drinkable. The passage also does not say that there is any shortage of cilantro. So all other options are baseless, and therefore the answer to this question is option A. Let's look at the next CR question in the next slide. Okay, now take a look at this other CR question. It says, which of the following strengthens the author's point of view? Okay, so if we need to understand which of the following strengthens the argument, I need to know what conclusion the argument ends, right? The argument is, while gym class may seem like an extraneous part of an academic program, getting aerobic exercise can help students to learn and remember more. That means physical activity makes children learn more, improves the memory of a student. A small study of 48 students between the ages 9 to 10 showed that those with higher levels of physical fitness performed better on mental tests. So this is an example of the first statement. Gym classes, it seems, may not just be critical for learning, maybe just as critical for learning as reading and writing. So clearly the main idea in the passage is physical fitness performed better on higher level of physical fitness means better performance on mental tests. Okay, that is, physical fitness improves one's mental fitness also. Okay, so if there is any of these options that bring us to this conclusion, that is going to be the answer. Now option A says, research among elderly people suggests that improved blood flow can keep neurons healthy and efficient, which can maintain nerve networks and improve cognitive functions. Now this particular option assumes that the blood flow of a person can improve by doing physical activity, which is incorrect. So we cannot really assume that. So this renders option A incorrect. Option B says, the scientists cannot describe exactly how aerobic fitness helps learning and memory. This completely does not make sense, because it is If at all, it weakens the argument, not strengthen it. Research has shown that aerobic fitness influences children's neurological processes in potentially significant ways, thus leading to better cognitive activities. So this supports the argument. Aerobic fitness leading to better cognitive abilities means it is going to affect a person's learning, that is mental ability, and therefore this is the correct answer. Option D says, in a 2012 report from the Centers of Diabetes Control, about half of high school surveyed said that they provided physical exercise classes during an average week, and also they got good grades in their studies. This only talks about, physical exercises, that students scoring good grades while they were into a routine of physical exercise, while we do not know about their previous performance. This renders option D incorrect. So the correct answer to this question is option C. Now another question is on CR. It gives gives two statements and then asks you to find out which of the given conclusions follow. Okay, let's understand what these two statements mean. One is sugar is bad for people with diabetes. So people who are suffering from diabetes, sugar is bad for them. Kritika does not eat sugar. Okay, now Kritika is diabetic. First conclusion is Kritika is diabetic. This is incorrect. Kritika does not eat sugar does not mean that she is diabetic. She may not eat sugar because she does not like sugar. She may also not eat, or maybe because she is a health freak and she thinks that sugar can make her obese. So there could be n number of reasons why Kritika does not eat sugar. It may not be just that she is diabetic. So this conclusion cannot be definitely be arrived at. B says people with diabetes do not eat sugar. This is also incorrect. If something is bad for somebody, does not mean that the person does not indulge in doing that. Right? So if somebody is a sugar patient, right, is a diabetic patient, he may not have any control on his eating habits, despite the fact that he knows that eating sugar is harmful for that person's health. Okay, like for example, smokers, they know that smoking cigarettes is injurious to health, to their health, but they would smoke. Because why? Because that is their own personal choice. Right, so therefore option B here is incorrect. C says Kritika does not like sugar. This also cannot be arrived at. As I have discussed, there could be n number of reasons why Kritika does not eat sugar. Not that she is diabetic, not even that she does not like sugar. Okay, so the answer to this question is option D.
In this problem, Ram distributed X toffees among his friends in such a way that each of his friends got an equal number of toffees. It means if there are k friends, then the total number of toffees with Ramu, which is x, will be k into some quantity, let's say it is p. And now it is given that had he given exactly 5 toffees to each of his friends, he would have been left with 12 toffees, which means had he given 5 toffees to each of his friends, then the total number of toffees received by his friends will be 5k, plus the remaining toffees, which is 12, will be equal to x, whereas had he given 6 toffees, he would have been left with 6 toffees, which means 6 into k plus 6. From here we get k equals 6, and now it is asking how many values of x lies between 40 and 90. So value of x at k equals 6 will be 42, and this is a unique value, so there would not be any other value of x in this range. Therefore option B is the correct answer. Here we have a grid of 3 cross 3, and each cell of the grid has a number, and we have to find the number which can replace x. And it is also given that number in each of the 9 cells has some common feature, and on closer look we can see that the sum of digits in each cell, or the sum of digits of number in each cell, is 6. Like in first row, the number in the first cell, that is the leftmost cell, is 24, and sum of its digit is 6, and the number in the next cell is 15, again sum is the 6. So basically we have to see the option in which the sum of digits of number is 6, or number itself is 6, which is option A. This is a problem of time and work, which is considered one of the easiest topics of aptitude, especially in quant section. Here it is given that a group of 12 men working 11.66 hours a day can construct 5.92 kilometer long highway in 10 days, and it is asking find the time required by 24 men working 5.83 hours a day, and with each person twice as efficient as that in the earlier mentioned group, to construct a highway which is 11.84 kilometer long. We know that work is given by man into days into hours into efficiency. If there are two different work, then we represent MDHE by M1 D1 H1 E1. And for second work, we write W2 equals M2, D2, S2 and E2. And when we divide these two equations, we get Wn upon W2 equals M1, D1, H1, E1 upon M2, D2, S2, E2. In first case, W1 is 5.92 kilometer and W2 is 11.84 kilometer. M1, that is the number of men who work on the construction of work of 5.92 kilometer long highway. D1, the number of days taken by them, is 10. H1, number of hours for which they work each day, which is 11.66, and into E1, M2, 24, number of men who worked on the second project, into the time that they needed to complete this work, suppose it is x, into the number of hours for which they work each day, 5.83, and it is given that the efficiency of each person in this group is twice as much as it is in the earlier mentioned group. It means E2 is nothing but twice of E1. From here, E1 gets cancelled out by E1. On solving, we get x equals 10 days, which means the number of days that 24 men would take to complete a construction work of 11.84 kilometer long highway. working 5.83 hours per day will be 10 days, which is option B. This is one of the easiest questions in this paper. Here it is given that A plus B equals 10 and A cross B equals 5, and we have to find the value of A raised to power minus 1 plus B raised to power minus 1. This can be written as 1 by A plus 1 by B, which is equal to A plus B upon A into B. Now we have value of A plus B as well as A into B, so it will be 10 upon 5. This is equal to 2. Therefore, option A is the correct answer. In this problem, there are 6 spots P1 to P6 which are kept next to each other in a row, not necessarily in that order. There are 2 pots between P4 and P1. So let's draw the possible situations for this statement. Now it is given that P3, which is kept to the immediate left of P2, which means P3 and P2 are always together, and it is also given that P2 which is to the right of P5, so P5 should be left to the P2, and it is also known that P5 is kept at one of the extreme ends. Therefore 5 should be somewhere at the extreme left, and from here it becomes obvious that if this arrangement is to be completed, P3 and P2 will be between P1 and P5 like this. And finally, it is also given that P1 is kept to the left of P6. It means P6 has to be at the extreme most position. From here P5 will be just immediate left to P1 or P5. So this is the final arrangement. Now we have to find how many pots are there whose position can be determined uniquely. From the arrangement it is clear that there are 4 pots, the positions of which can be determined uniquely. Therefore, option D is the correct answer. This is a problem of number system based on the concept of factors. Here we have 20 boys who are to be seated in a row with an equal number of boys in each row. How many different values can n have? Here we have 20 boys and we have to make them sit in a few rows such that each row has the number of students equal, which means the number of students in each row has to be a factor of 20, and we know that the factor of 20 are 20, 10, 5, 4, 2, 1. When we consider this case, that is one student in each row, the number of row will be 20, and when we take 2 students in each row, number of rows will be 10, and so on. So there are 6 different ways in which these 20 boys can be made to sit in rows. So the number of different values that n can have is 6, which is option A. In this problem, a salesman accidentally lists the price of sugar in such a way that he incurred a loss of 20% by selling it at the less price, which means if cost price of sugar is rupees 100, shopkeeper list is as 80, which is 20% less than the cost price. Later on, he decides to use a faulty weight to make a profit of 60%, which means he wants to earn rupees 160 on an investment of rupees 100 by selling it at the list price and using faulty weight. So here it is asking, faulty weight is what percent less than the actual weight. Here shopkeeper want to weigh just the quantity which he sells at rupees 80 without any treacherous activity or using faulty weight. So he has to earn rupees 160 by selling the sugar that he used to sell earlier at rupees 80, wherein he would use a faulty weight. So basically he needs to weigh half of the quantity what he should actually give to the customer. So here weight should be half of the actual weight, which means it should be 50% less than the actual weight. That is option B. This is a problem of ratio and it is quite simple. It is given that a man divides 900 rupees in three parts. It is known that half of the first part, let the first part be X, second part be Y, and third part be Z. Half of the first part, that is X by 2, 1/3 of the second part, Y by 3, and 1/4 of the third part are equal. So this is the condition. Find the sum of the second and third parts. We have to find the value of Y plus Z. Now we know that X plus Y plus Z is 900, and if we take X by 2, Y by 3 or Z by 4 as some constant K, we get X equals 2K, Y equals 3K and Z equals 4K. On substituting these values of X, Y and Z in this equation, we get 9K equals 900. From here we get K equals 100, and we have to find value of Y plus Z, which is nothing but 3K plus 4K, that is 7K. So the required value will be 7 into 100, that is 700 rupees, which is option D. This is a problem of probability where 5 identical coins are tossed one after another, and it is asking what is the probability that the fourth coin shows head if the two among the first three coins show head and other tail. We know that when a coin is tossed, it has nothing to do with whether some coins have tossed earlier or not. So when a coin is tossed, its outcome is independent of coin toss earlier. So basically it is nothing but the simple problem of probability when a coin is tossed, and it is asked what is the probability of getting head, and we know that probability of getting head is 1 by 2, and the same is the case with shell. So here simply we just have to see what is the probability of getting head when a coin is tossed, rather than being concerned about outcome of the earlier coins, as they have nothing to do with the outcome that we would get on the fourth coin. Therefore, option B is the correct answer. This is a problem of time, speed and distance. Here, Aman can swim at a speed of 3 km in still water, that is in absence of current. And it is also given that the speed of current is 1 km per hour, and we have to find the time taken by him to swim to and fro a distance of 7.5 km. In one way of journey, he has to encounter current while going other way round, he'll be assisted by the current. So suppose first he travels against current, in that case his effective speed will be 2 minus 1, and while returning he is assisted by current, in that case his speed will be 2 plus 1. On solving we get this quantity as 10. So the time that he would need to travel to and fro a distance of 7.5 km is 10 hours. This is option C. This is a problem of profit and loss, where it is given that a shopkeeper while selling an article earns a profit that is equal to 20% of its selling price. If selling price of the article is 100, shopkeeper earns 20% on its selling price, that is 20, which means shopkeeper earns a profit of 20%. Therefore, cost price of the article has to be 100 minus 20, which is 80. And here it is asking what would have been the percentage profit loss made by the shopkeeper had he sold the article at a price which is 10% less than the original selling price. Original selling price is 100, so what would have been the profit had the selling price been 90? And we know that cost price of the article is 80, so in that case profit will be of 10 over 80. This is nothing but 12.5%. Therefore, option A is the correct answer.
It is a problem of clock, which can be considered as a simple problem. Here it is given that at what time after 3:20 p.m. will the hour and minute hands of a clock makes an angle of 75 degree. We know that the angle between minute and hour hand at any given point in time is 30 h, where h is the position of hour hand, and 11/2 m, where m is the position of minute hand. Here theta is the angle between the minute and hour hands, which is 75 in the given problem. So 75 is equal to mod of 30 minus h, which is the position of hour hand. In this problem it is 3 minus 11/2 into m, the position of which we have to find. On solving this, we get m equals 30/11 और 30. सो द टाइम्स आफ्टर 3 o'clock व्हेन मिनट हैंड एंड आर हैंड आर एट 75 डिग्री आर 3:30 by 11 एंड 3:30. हेयर वी हैव टू फाइंड द टाइम विच कम्स आफ्टर 3:20. सो द रिक्वायर्ड टाइम विल बी 3:30. देयरफॉर ऑप्शन डी इज द करेक्ट आंसर. इन दिस प्रॉब्लम 3 of the 4 गिवन ऑप्शंस आर अलाइक एंड दस दे फॉर्म अ ग्रुप एंड वी हैव टू फाइंड द ऑप्शन इन विच द आइटम डज नॉट बिलोंग टू द ग्रुप. अमंग द फोर ऑप्शंस सर्कल इज द फिगर दैट इज नॉट कंपोज ऑफ साइड्स और स्ट्रीट लाइन्स वेर एज रेस्ट ऑफ द थ्री फिगर्स आर कंपोज ऑफ स्ट्रीट लाइन्स. ट्राइंगल इज कंपोज ऑफ थ्री लाइन्स. पेंटागन इज कंपोज ऑफ फाइव लाइन्स एंड हेक्टागन इज कंपोज ऑफ सेवन लाइन्स. देयरफॉर आइटम गिवन इन ऑप्शन डी डज नॉट बिलोंग टू द ग्रुप टू विच द रेस्ट ऑफ द थ्री ऑप्शंस बिलोंग टू. देयरफॉर ऑप्शन डी इज द करेक्ट आंसर. दिस इज अ प्रॉब्लम ऑफ डायरेक्शन एंड इन प्रॉब्लम्स फ्रॉम दिस एरिया वी जस्ट नीड टू ड्रॉ अ फिगर इन अकॉर्डेंस विद द गिवन इंफॉर्मेशन एंड सी वॉट डायरेक्शन और डिस्टेंस इट इज टॉकिंग अबाउट. हेयर इट इज गिवन दैट अंकित एंड अर्पित स्टार्टेड मूविंग फ्रॉम पॉइंट पी टूवर्ड्स नॉर्थ एंड ईस्ट डायरेक्शन रिस्पेक्टिवली. अर्पित मूव्स इन स्टार्ट मूविंग इन नॉर्थ डायरेक्शन एंड अंकित इन ईस्ट डायरेक्शन. एंड इट इज ऑल्सो गिवन दैट अर्पित took 2 left 1 right and 1 left turn 1 left 2 second left 1st right and then left. This will be the final position of Arpit. While Ankit took 1 right 2 left turn in the given order, which means 1 left and 2nd left. So final position of Ankit will be this. And here it is also given that if each of them covered a distance of 10 meter before and after taking a turn, which means all these distances are 10 meter. And here we have to find the direction of Ankit with respect to Arpit. Arpit is here and Ankit is at this position. And we know that this is the parity of direction north, south, east, west, northeast, south, north, west, west, south, south east. So if we compare this moment with the direction, then we find that Ankit is to the northeast of Arpit. Therefore option D is the correct answer. In this problem there are 5 professors and they belong to 5 different departments from among P to T, and only one department is assigned to a professor. It is also known that from out of the given 5 statements, it is obvious that E belongs to Q, and apart from this, we know that A belongs to either R and P, B belongs to neither P and T, C belongs to either T or R, and D belongs to either S or R. So there are two possible cases for A, and these are: A either belongs to R or it belongs to P. Suppose A belongs to R, so from here we get from statement 3 that C belongs to T and D belongs to S. So from here only one department that is left for B is P, but which contradicts statement 2. Therefore this case is not possible. Consider the second case when A belongs to P, and it is already known that E belongs to Q, and after having a look at the statement 2 and 3, it becomes obvious that T belongs to C, or C belongs to department T, and therefore the remaining two departments, these are R and S, can go to either B or D. Therefore B belongs to either R or S, similarly D belongs to either S or R. So this is the valid case. Now coming to the first question of this set, where it is asking who belongs to department P. From the arrangement it is clear that A belongs to P, therefore option A is the correct answer. Coming to the next question, here it is asking D belongs to which department. From the arrangement it is clear that D belongs to either S or R. Therefore option D is the correct answer. Now coming to the last question, where it is asking how many different combinations of professors and the department assigned to them are possible. As we know that B belongs to either S or R, and similarly D belongs to these two, one out of these two departments only. So there are two possible combinations of professor and the departments assigned to them, which is option B. This is a problem of blood relation, which is of easy difficulty level. Here we know that Kishan is the son of only child of grandfather of Gurmeet, only child of grandfather of Gurmeet will be Gurmeet's father or mother, and it is also known that Kishan is the son of only child of Gurmeet's grandfather. Therefore Kishan has to be sibling of Gurmeet, and here we have to find how is Gurmeet related to Kishan. In fact Kishna, as we do not know what is the gender of Gurmeet, we cannot find the correct relationship between Gurmeet and Kishna. Therefore it has to be either a relation of brother or sister, which is option D.
In a class, 30% of students failed in English, 60% in Hindi, and 10% passed in both the subjects. If each student of the class appeared for at least one of the two tests, then what percentage of students passed in only English? Let's draw a Venn diagram. This is English, this is Hindi. Suppose these circle represents a student who passed in English, passed in Hindi, and the common region represents the region where a student passed in both the subjects. 30% of students failed in English, which means this is the region where a student failed in English. But here we need to understand one thing, and that is whether all the students appeared for both the subjects or not. If we go by the second line of the question, which states if each student of the class appeared for at least one of the two tests, from here it is quite obvious that we cannot find whether all the students appeared for both the subjects or not. So from here we can conclude that it is not known what percent of the total students appeared for both the subjects. So it is not possible for us to find the percentage of students who appeared for any particular subject out of these two and those who appeared for both the subjects. So it is not possible for us to find the percentage of students who passed in only English. Therefore, the answer of this problem is cannot be determined, which is option D.
In this problem, Sunil finds himself at 15th position from the front of a queue when he moves two places ahead, which means Sunil finds himself at the 15th position when he moves two places ahead, which means before moving his position was 15 plus 2 from the front end of the queue, which is 17th. And it is also given that at the 5th position from the end when he moves 3 places behind, which means when he moves from a fixed position to 3 places behind, his position becomes 5th from the behind of the queue. It means before moving his position was 8th from the behind, which means his position is 8th from the behind. And it is also known that his position is 17th from the front. Therefore, the total number of persons in the queue will be 17th plus 7 more who are standing behind him. Therefore, the total number of persons in the queue will be 24, which is option A.
This set is of linear arrangement of moderate difficulty level, in which there are 5 friends A to E who are standing in a row subject to the following conditions, including 3 of them facing north and the rest to south. From statement 2nd and 3rd, it can be concluded that C is facing south, who is standing to the left of E. So E has to be right of C, which means position of E should be something like this, and it is also given that in next statement, that is statement 3, that there are only two people who are standing between C and D. So either these two people could be right of C or left of C. It is not possible to identify to which direction these two people are standing between C and D. But if we combine statement first and fifth, we get to know that D and E are standing at extreme ends, and D is to the left of E, who is facing north. So it should be like this. There are two positions between D and E, and E is to the left, to the right of C. From here it becomes obvious C is standing immediate left of E. Now coming to the statement fourth, here it is given that A is standing to the immediate right of B and D, which means A is at this position and facing north, and B is immediate right of A, and he is facing south. So this is the arrangement. Now coming to the first question of this set, here it is asking who is sitting next to E. From the arrangement it can be seen that C is sitting next to E, which is option C. In next question it is asking who is in the middle. Again from the arrangement it can be seen that B is standing at the middle position. In the third question of this set, we have to find the two persons who are facing south. From the arrangement it can be seen that B and C are facing south. Now coming to the last question, in which we have to identify how many of the given three statements are true. In first statement it is given that B is standing between D and C, which is true as per the arrangement. In second statement it is given that only A is standing between D and C, which is incorrect as there are two people who are standing between D and C. Now coming to the last question statement, in which it is given that D is standing to the left of A, which is not correct as B is standing to the right of A. Therefore statement second and third are incorrect. Hence option A is the correct answer, as there is only one statement which is true. This is a set of two problems based on time speed distance. Sanjay travelled from Mathura to Delhi by using the four cars. The following table shows the details regarding cars, their speeds and distance covered by them. In the table it can be seen that he travelled a distance of 25 km using Fiat, 45 km Mustang, 50 Ambassador and 54 km by Maruti 800. It can be noted that couple of his speeds are given in term of kilometer per hour and the remaining two in term of meter per second. So convert the speed which are given in meter per second into kilometer per hour, and this can be done by multiplying this figure by 18 by 5. This comes out to be 9 kilometer per hour, and the speed at which he traveled by Maruti 800 will be 5 into 18 by 5, which is 18 kilometer per hour. Now moving to the question, in the first question it is asking find the average of the speeds of vehicles used by Sanjay during the entire journey. The speeds of the vehicles that Sanjay used are 25, 45, 50 and 54, and we have to find average of these figures. So we just need to divide, add these figures and divide the sum by 4, and we get the required average as 14.25 kilometer per hour, which means option A is the correct answer. Now coming to the next question, in this question we have to find time taken by Sanjay to cover the entire distance. Time taken is distance upon speed, and it is known that he covers 25 kilometer by feet at a speed 10 kilometer per hour, and next 45 kilometer by Mustang at a speed 9 kilometer per hour. Similarly, he covers 50 kilometer by Ambassador at a speed 20 kilometer per hour, and 54 kilometer by Maruti 800 at a speed 18 kilometer per hour, and this sum comes out to be 13. So the time taken by Sanjay to cover the entire distance is 13 hour, which is option C.
This is a problem of data interpretation, in which we have a pie chart which gives breakup of students of a class who are good at one of the five subjects, and these subjects are history, civics, polity, science and English. And it is also given that no student is good at more than one subject. From the chart we can see that English stands for 180 degree out of 360, as we know that pie chart stands for 360 degree until unless it is given otherwise. And similarly we can see the proportion of civics out of the total students, which is 72%, 72 degree out of 360 degree. That's all about chart. Now coming to the question, in first question it is asking to find the total number of students in the class. If it is given that the number of students who are good at history is 12, here 54 degree stands for 12 and we have to find the value of 360 degree. So basically it will be 12 into 360 upon 54. On solving it we get it as 80. So the number of students in the class is 80 when there are 12 students who like history. Now coming to the next question, in this question it is given that the strength of class is 150, and we have to find the difference between the number of students who are good at science and those who are good at English. So basically we have to find 180 minus 36 upon 360 into 150, but before simplifying this expression, we need to check whether 150 would be a consistent figure, that is, will give an integral number of students for each of the subjects or not. On checking, we find that when total number of students in the class is 150, then the number of students who like history will not be an integer. So the data given in this problem is inconsistent or does not give integral value of students who like history. Now coming to the next problem, in this it is asking what is the ratio of the students who are good at polity. Polity, that is 90 degree, to those who are good at English, that is 108 degree, if the strength of class is 40. Here we don't need strength of class to answer this question, so 40 is a redundant data for answering this question. So required answer will be 5:6, that is option D. Now coming to the last question of this set, here we have to find the number of students who are good at polity, 90 degree is what percent more than those who are good at civics. Civics is 72 degree, so basically we have to find 90 is what percent more than that of 72. It will be 90 minus 72 upon 72 into 100, which comes out to be 25%. Therefore option B is the correct answer. This is a problem of data interpretation in which we have a pie chart which gives breakup of students of a class who are good at one of the five subjects, and these subjects are history, civics, polity, science and English, and it is also given that no student is good at more than one subject. From the chart we can see that English stands for 180 degree out of 360, as we know that pie chart stands for 360 degree until unless it is given otherwise. And similarly we can see the proportion of civics out of the total students, which is 72%, 72 degree out of 360 degree. That's all about chart. Now coming to the question, in first question it is asking to find the total number of students in the class. If it is given that the number of students who are good at history is 12, here 54 degree stands for 12 and we have to find the value of 360 degree. So basically it will be 12 into 360 upon 54. On solving it we get it as 80. So the number of students in the class is 80 when there are 12 students who like history. Now coming to the next question, in this question it is given that the strength of class is 150 and we have to find the difference between the number of students who are good at science and those who are good at English. So basically we have to find 180 minus 36 upon 360 into 150, but before simplifying this expression, we need to check whether 150 would be a consistent figure, that is, will give an integral number of students for each of the subjects or not. On checking, we find that when total number of students in the class is 150, then the number of students who like history will not be an integer. So the data given in this problem is inconsistent or does not give integral value of students who like history. Now coming to the next problem, in this it is asking what is the ratio of the students who are good at polity, that is 90 degree, to those who are good at English, that is 108 degree, if the strength of class is 40. Here we don't need a strength of class to answer this question, so 40 is a redundant data for answering this question. So required answer will be 5:6, that is option D. Now coming to the last question of this set, here we have to find the number of students who are good at polity, 90 degree is what percent more than those who are good at civics? Civics is 72 degree. So basically we have to find 90 is what percent more than that of 72. It will be 90 minus 72 upon 72 into 100, which comes out to be 25%. Therefore option B is the correct answer.
In this problem we have to find the number of squares in the given diagram. It's always better to count the squares in ascending order of their dimension. So if we look for the squares of smallest possible dimension, and these are at the corners of the rectangles and are 8 in numbers. Now the square of dimension bigger than this are 1, 2, 3, and 4. Now the square of dimension which is bigger than just what we counted are these, and these are 5 in numbers. Finally, we have a square of highest dimension, which is this. Therefore, there are 18 squares in this diagram. Therefore, option B is the correct answer.
In the following figure, circle represents students playing cricket, triangle represents students playing hockey, and square represents students playing chess. And we have to find the region where the students who play both cricket and chess but not hockey. So this is the region which represents the students who play cricket and chess but not hockey. So the required region is 2, which is option B.
In this problem we have to complete the question figure, find the answer figure which can do the same. Here we don't need to do anything, just we need to complete the figure and see which of the option figure correspond to that. On completing the figure we can see that option B correspond corresponds to the figure which is required to complete the question figure. Therefore, option B is the correct answer. This is a problem of number system of moderate difficulty level based on LCM and SCF. Here it is given that the sum of two numbers is 84 and their SCF and LCM is 7 and 245 respectively. The smaller among the two numbers is, so let one of the numbers be X and the other number in this case will be 84 minus X, as the sum of these two numbers is 84, and we know that product of two numbers is always equal to the product of their LCM and SCF. So from here we get X into 84 minus X equals 7 into 245. On simplifying this equation we get X square minus 84 X plus 1715 equals 0. On simplifying this equation we get X minus 35 into X minus 49 equals 0. From here we get X as 35 and 49, which means if one number is 35 then other number will be 84 minus 35, which is 49. So smaller of these two numbers is 35, which is option B.
This is a problem of ratio and it is quite easy. Here it is given that 1/3 of A, 1/3 of A is equivalent to 3/5 of B. From here we get A by B as 9/5, and we have to find value of 3A minus 2B upon 3A plus 2B. On dividing both numerator and denominator by B we get 3 into A by B minus 2 upon 3 into A by B plus 2, and we know the value of A by B. From here we get 3 into 9/5 minus 2 upon 3 into 9/5 plus 2. It comes out to be 17 upon 37, which is option C.
The following diagram shows the two different positions of a dice and we have to find the number that is opposite to A1. From the two figures it can be noted that the faces which are adjacent to 1 are 3, 4, 5 and 6, as two adjacent faces to 1 are 3 and 4 in the first figure, and that in and 5 and 6 are adjacent to 1 in the second figure. So the four adjacent faces to 1 are known to us, then we can easily find the face opposite to 1, and it will be 2 in this case, as the adjacent faces to 1 are 3, 4, 5, 6. Therefore the required answer is B.
This is a problem of visual reasoning in which three of the four figures are connected or share a common feature and one figure does not belong to that category. We have to identify the pattern that exists in each figure. and then identify the figure which does not exhibit the same feature. If we see in the first figure or the figure in option A, we see there is a triangle and a quadrilateral, and the difference between the sides of these two polygons is 1. Coming to the next figure, we have quadrilateral and pentagon. Again, the difference between the two polygons in this figure is 1. Coming to the next figure, we see the difference between the polygons in this figure, which are triangle and pentagon, is 2. And again, in the last figure, the difference is of 1. So from here, obviously C, or the figure given in C, does not exhibit the same feature that other three figures represent. So it has to be our answer. Therefore, option C is the correct answer. Here we have two numbers which are in the ratio 5:3. So let the numbers be 5x and 3x. And it is also given that the sum of their squares is 7650. And we have to find the absolute difference between the two numbers. So as per the given condition, 5x square plus 3x square is equal to 7650. Here it is 25x square plus 9x square equals 7650. From here we get x square as 7650 upon 34, which comes out to be 225. From here we get x as 15, not minus 15, because here it is given that the given numbers are positive numbers. Now we have to find the difference between the two numbers, and these numbers are 5x and 3x. So the difference will be twice of x, which will be equal to 2 into 15, that is equal to 30. And this is option B.